This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do. All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
It has been called the aspirin of horseback riding because it fixes everything. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb for The Horse Show. I'm talking about a move in the sport of dressage that is called the shoulder in. This is not particularly new. It's been around for several hundred years, in fact. It started out as a training exercise practiced on a circle, and then it became a move in the sport of dressage that was done along a straight wall. But it's a training exercise. It's an athleticizing exercise, and we'll find out why it is so valuable to learn and what the possibilities are for expanding it outside of the sport of dressage. And if you happen to be a reiner or a roper or a jumper or any number of other sports, why you might want to practice this too. I went to the best, folks. Jane Savoie is my guest to talk about the shoulder in. And if you don't know Jane's name, you should. She is an international superstar, a competitor at that level in the sport of dressage, a coach for Olympic teams, author of several books, four books, I believe, now, and a motivational speaker. Just one of our best and most talented people in the horse industry. She's my guest today. We'll talk about the shoulder in. But before that, I'm going to talk to a young lady that is very impressive in her own right, Sammi Jo Stohler. I met her in Idaho at the Horse Affairs Expo in Boise not too long ago. And she had done this incredible act in the evening performance with her stallion, a trick stallion she had taught to buck. And she kind of took us all in because we all thought the whole act was falling apart, and turns out that was part of it. So she'll tell us how she taught this horse to buck and whether that's really a good thing. You know, a lot of people wonder why you would teach a horse to do that, but she'll explain that. She also does some work with other kinds of animals, and in particular, the one that I was so interested in is a zebra. She's got a young zebra she's working with, and we'll learn about how different zebras are from horses. You might be surprised about that.
Very quickly, before we go to break, I want to tell you about the Hawaii Horse Expo for 2015. As always, a benefit for the HIHS Horse Rescue Fund. That's Hawaii Island Humane Society. This year, it's a little bit different. It's an equine wellness symposium featuring Dr. Robert Miller, Dr. Leslie Easterwood, Dr. Eric Mueller, Dr. Susan White, Dr. Lisa Wood, Dr. Billy Bergen, and yours truly, Dr. Rick Lamb. Yes, I finished my PhD finally. I know a lot of you have been following my journey on that. This is all happening September 11th through 13th, again on the Big Island of Hawaii. We would love to have you come. It is so much fun and so educational. Details at HawaiiHorseExpo.com. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. This is The Horse Show live from Horse Affairs in Boise, Idaho. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest for this segment of our program is Sammi Jo Stohler. Sammi Jo, welcome to The Horse Show.
Thank you.
I only met Sammi Jo personally today, but I had a chance to watch her last night in our evening performance, and she did a couple interesting things that I wanted to talk about. One, you've got a trick stallion. He does some things that I think the audience thought he was getting mad, he was getting out of control, but you actually taught him to do some of this. Describe that for us.
I worked with him a lot on some really fun work with bucking on command and kicking and rearing, and he's very well under control. In fact, I can tell him to kick right foot or left foot or both hind feet, or strike with right or left front foot, or rear on command wherever I want him to. So he only does it when I ask him, so I can be completely comfortable with him in crowds of people. I can, children come around him all the time, and I can let other people work with him as well.
Well, I felt so sorry for you last night. You went to put this saddle pad on his back, then he bucked it right off, and I thought, oh man, how embarrassing for her, but she's going to try it again, and you did it about 3 times. Now, wait a second, this is on purpose. So it reeled me in.
Yeah, I've taught him to buck off the saddle pad, and he only bucks off what I want him to. I can, saddle him and ride him just like any other horse.
Do you give him some kind of little cue Okay, tell us the secret cue. What is it?
Well, there's a lot of different ones. It's a lot just pressures, and he knows when I want him to do it. I couldn't even hardly tell you what I'm doing to make him do it exactly. I don't know if I could tell you, and you have him. You walk up to him and tell him to do it. I don't know if he would.
Is there just that kind of connection between the minds that
I think
he
so.
Knows
I'm,
what you want?
I'm sure I'm doing something.
So he senses the intent. He mm-hmm. knows what you want. He's what, about 8 years old now?
No, he is 6.
He's 6,
so
okay.
So he's still very young. Actually, I helped deliver his mother. So we have had his family for several generations, and first thing I saw out of him was a white foot peeking out of mama. So,
did you do some imprint training with him, get in there and handle him and start working
yep.
with him right
we
away?
We work with all of our babies as soon as they're born. We work with them until they're ready to get up, and then once they stand, we let them bond with mama for a while, and then we work with them a little bit more the first day.
The thing I suppose that was the most interesting for me is the bucking on the ground was one thing, but then you climbed on it. Well, first of all, you got him to go down so that you could step on him very easily. No vaulting onto the back. Didn't have to do that. He went all the way down on the ground, and then you climbed on his back, and he stood up. And then on cue, although it wasn't real clear at first that you were cueing him, he started bucking.
Yep. Yeah, he'll do bucking in place, which is a capriole in English. They use that a lot in the cavalry maneuvers. And that's kind of what I started with, doing some cavalry maneuvers, just to see, how it would turn out. And
I never thought of that as being bucking, the capriole. I just, they talk about it as these leaping movements, the air's above the ground. But I guess in a sense it is like bucking.
It's very similar. I mean, it's a lot more collected and, very controlled, of course. But I have him buck in place, and then I can have him go forward and buck as we're actually going forward. And last night I actually almost came off once, and he corrected me really well.
Really?
He'll only buck as many times as I want him to in a row. And if I ask him to buck, and last night I got a little farther forward and I got a little off to the side, and boy, he jumped right underneath of me. So
wow.
He's very considerate about that. So.
Now, what made you decide to teach a horse to do something like bucking?
Don't laugh.
Most of us live in fear of a horse doing that. You actually went out and taught him to do it.
I read it in a book once.
How to teach your horse to buck in five easy lessons, or
no,
what?
No, it was some cheesy Western, like a Louis L'Amour or something.
Oh, really? I've read most of those. I'll have to find that one. So it must have been kind of hard in the beginning to get the idea across to him.
Not really. It was actually very easy to teach him to do it. I wouldn't ever do it with any other horse, and it's just because he is so mellow and so easy to work with.
So he's not inclined to buck normally at all?
No, not at all. No, I gave riding lessons on him as a three-year-old. So here's a three-year-old stallion, and I was giving riding lessons to beginners. First time people who had ridden a horse for the first time in their life rode him. And he was just terrific, and that's the reason I used him, was because he was just so mellow.
Yeah, and the kicking that he did was very funny, because we have this arena where they brought in, about almost a foot of sand or something, and when he was kicking, it was like he was launching sand at people in the audience.
It's my own Shamu show.
Yeah. Well, that was really neat, and I thought, wow, how did you get to be such a good rider that you could sit through a buck like that? Is it just because you know it's coming?
Yeah, I know it's coming. That's a big part of it. I've never had any formal instructions. I've never had a single riding instruction in my life. And I've been out in the middle of nowhere. You know, you ride your horses and you learn how. And I rode every day of my life, practically. And
have you ever been bucked off?
Oh, that's a silly question.
I would say yes, then.
Yes, definitely. Okay. I've been bucked out of the saddle twice. Bareback,
well,
I have been dumped more times than that. There's a difference between being bucked off and being dumped.
Okay, what's the distinction?
Well, if you're dumped, it's your fault, or you're riding a mule. Mules dump you, they don't buck you off.
Oh, interesting.
They're smarter than that.
They just kind of cause you to lose your balance and slide off or something?
Yeah, they'll wait until you're off balance. And,
then kind of, oh.
Yeah, nine times out of ten, they're standing absolutely still by the time you hit the ground.
Well, I had nothing to do with that. Tell us about Chester.
All right, Chester is a zebra. He is an eight-month-old. Well, now he's 8 months old. He's a Damara zebra. And I got him when he was 4 days old and have been working with him, and he is just awesome. He is so fun to work with.
What possessed you to get a wild animal, which is what a zebra is, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely a wild animal. Somebody told me I couldn't. And don't ever tell me I can't. I'll try and prove it wrong. I might not succeed, but I'll try. But I got him, and I did 2 years of research before I got him, talking to breeders, talking to people in circuses, talking to people in zoos. More people are injured or killed in zoos by zebras than any other animal, including predators and poisonous animals. So there's all these facts that are floating around, and then you have some people who have trained them to ride, who have been able to drive them and work with them, and so you get very conflicting messages of whether they're mean animals or whether they're just animals. So I want to find out for myself.
And what did you find out?
Well, it's hard to say yet. He's only 8 months old, so at the moment he is just, he's better than most of my horse colts to work with.
But zebras do change as they get older, and we'll find out how when I continue talking to Sammi Jo Stohler at Horse Affairs in Boise, Idaho. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Sammi Jo Stohler, and we were just talking about how zebras differ from horses.
When zebras mature, when they reach about 2 to 3 years old, sometimes up to 4, their hormones start kicking in, and they become adults. And when they become adults, if they think that you're a zebra or they think that they're a person, they'll either try to possess you as part of their herd or you're competing with them. So you don't ever want them to think that they have to compete with you or they have to possess you, because you're not going to win either way. And that's the big point, is when they get mature, they want a herd of their own. And that can work very much against you. So a lot of people have trouble when they reach that maturity and they turn on them, they get attacked, they get hurt. So that's a big point. I'm going to see if his training as a foal pays off when he becomes an adult.
How do they attack? Do they bite? Do they kick? Both?
Mostly they bite. Front legs are usually the primary weapon. But if they will, of course, turn and kick. They can be very, very dangerous animals.
Wow. So they're psychologically, they sound a bit different from horses then.
They're quite a bit different. Their herd mentality is a lot different than horses, in the fact that plains zebras herd for life. A stallion cannot steal another mare from another herd. He'll steal the young fillies, but he cannot steal the mare, because that is her herd and she will not leave it. Wow. So they have extremely strong herd bonds. So we'll see how that works.
It seems to me that I heard someplace that zebras were used actually, I believe it was in Africa, to haul carts or as beasts of burden, mm-hmm. because they had a more of an, if not an immunity, at least a resistance to the tsetse fly.
It's tsetse fly. It's pronounced two different ways.
But that causes what? Malaria, is it?
Or? It can cause, well, it's called African equine sickness. I'm sure that there's lots of other terms for it, but it kills lots of horses, and apparently zebras are immune to it. At least it doesn't affect them. It kills the horses, but they had such a problem with the flies, both irritating the horses and making them sick, that they were running out of horses. So they started using zebras in working the big plantations in the fields and pulling stage lines and freight carts. So it went over pretty good for a while, but they found that they didn't have nearly the endurance that a horse does, and it took longer to train them. So that,
and of course, when they got older, then they started, their hormones kicked in and all of that.
Yeah, most of the zebras that you'll see in circuses performing are under 2 years old.
Ah. Now, you mentioned there's 3 breeds of zebras that still exist today?
Well, there'll be 3 species, and then within each species, there are different breeds.
Okay. So what are the species of zebras that exist
there's
today?
There's the grevies, the mountains, and the plains zebra. And the plains zebras are the only ones that are not endangered.
And so Chester, being a Damara,
uh-huh.
is one of the plains
yes.
zebras? Okay. And he's fairly small. Of course, he's not that old yet. He's 8 months old. How tall do you expect him to be to grow eventually?
He should be around 13 hands, 700 pounds.
Like a pony, then.
We'll see how big he gets. But
do other breeds or species of zebras get bigger than that?
Yep.
I tended to think, I was surprised how small he was. And I know he's young. But I kind of expected, when I think of zebras, I think of them being bigger for some reason.
There's the Grevy's zebras are much bigger. They're much more primitive in their structure. But they can get up to 15 hands, 1,100 pounds. Yeah. Some of them, most of them aren't quite that big, but they will get horse size.
I refer to them as being equines. Are they equines?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
I think genetically, isn't there another type of animal called the onager that still exists today that's kind of part of this, maybe the equid genus or whatever?
I know the... You stumped me with this one.
Okay. I stumped her. I can't believe it.
Dang. I'm going to have to go do some research tonight now.
Uh-oh.
Find that out.
Sorry about
that. Oh, the onagers, are those the Asian...
I think so.
Yeah,
I think
the wild horses.
Yeah,
in Asia.
They don't look nearly as much like horses as zebras do.
The horse, they're the same.
Probably all part of that same family. There's some other exotic animals in your life, or you've had in your life some exotic deer, and I saw a pelican there. I couldn't imagine why all of these mammals, and all of a sudden in the middle of this is a pelican. Why a pelican? Let's start with that.
That was a really strange story. We do some rehab on a lot of different animals, including wild animals, and they just kind of find their way to us. And Mom was out in the field in December last year, and all of a sudden she sees something move out in the snow, and she walks out there, and here is this pelican sitting out in the snow, and she couldn't figure out what was wrong with it. Well, he started to move, and somebody had shot him in the wing, mistaking him for a snow goose. And so we brought him in and took care of him, and that was one of the most awesome experiences of my life.
Did he recover okay?
Actually, he didn't, unfortunately. We had him for a couple of weeks, and in that time, usually an adult wild animal that's injured has a very, very low chance of surviving, mostly because of the stress. But he adapted so quickly. By the third day, he was following you around looking for treats and looking for his fish, but he ended up with infection. So.
Now, how close are you to the ocean where you live?
I'm a long ways from the ocean. So, I'm on eastern Oregon.
Okay, so why? What was he doing that far inland?
They nest on the lakes that are close to where I live, and their main lake was dried up that year, so they used our lake to nest on. So that was really neat. There was a couple hundred of them there. I've worked with a lot of different deer and antelope, and I had an antelope a couple years ago I rehabbed, and he was... really fun. You know, we released him back into the herd that's over there, and you know, the chances are he might have ended up with a coyote anyway, but the experience was
you got in
really
and messed
fun.
With the with
oh yeah but who can look out there and see a little crippled antelope and not take
that.
Care of
yeah.
it
yeah so are you worried when you do release an animal like that back into the wild that they would be have diminished survival capabilities just from being with humans that long?
Oh yeah, you're gonna worry about that. Most of the time when I take care of a wild animal, they end up at a ranch or somewhere where they're gonna be looked after because it's very, very difficult, especially like with the antelope where I had to do a lot of physical therapy with him to keep them not associated with people. So I like to turn them loose on ranches so that people can watch over them and kind of make sure that they don't like stand out in the highway or get eaten by a coyote.
Well, you are certainly an interesting lady and somebody who's got a lot of different interests. Do you have some focus that you're going to move forward and kind of specialize in one of these areas, or do you think you'll just continue doing all this stuff that you do?
Oh, I don't know.
Because you're also a trainer and a clinician and
I write.
You teach all kinds of stuff.
If I find a spare minute in my day, I'm going to pick up a new hobby.
Yeah, that'll probably continue then.
Yeah, I'll just keep going with what I'm doing, and you know, whatever areas I have success in, that's
all
where
right.
I'll go.
My guest has been Sammi Jo Stohler, and Sammi Jo, you have a website. People could learn a little bit more about you.
My website is equidreams.info. That's equidreams.info. Lots of zebra information and training information on there.
Sammi Jo, thanks for being with
us today. Thank you.
Next up, the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers from the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo in Albany, Oregon. My guest is Jane Savoie. We'll talk about the shoulder-in exercise and why it is so good. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe. Thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order.
Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel the letter in corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Hey, we're back, everybody, coming to you today from the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo in Albany, Oregon. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. And my guest for this segment of our program is the great Jane Savoie.
Oh,
welcome.
Goodness. Thank you.
So nice to have you with us again.
Yes. The last time I saw you, we were dodging snowflakes, I think, in Minnesota.
In Minnesota, yeah. I remember we were both all, we didn't even take off our coats. So we looked like
That's
Eskimos
right.
up there, and you could see our breath, I think, actually. We're going to talk about the shoulder in exercise today and why it's so important. I promised Jane that I would say a few words about the history of this. And the only reason I know anything about it is because of this book that I've written with Dr. Robert Miller called The Revolution in Horsemanship. So just let me tell you a little bit that I learned about this. The first thing is that the movement we know today in shoulder in was that's called shoulder in dressage was originally a training exercise performed on a circle by the Englishman William Cavendish, who we also know as the Duke of Newcastle. Now, it was adapted by Francois, and you correct me if I pronounce this wrong, Francois Robuchon de la Garinere. Garinere, we just call him, who is anybody that knows dressage probably knows this name. He's considered the father of classical equitation and the patron saint of dressage. Among the many things that he contributed to dressage, and by the way, his methods are still taught today in the Spanish riding school. I mean, that is kind of the dressage that we have today. His most famous invention of all was the shoulder in, and he invented a number of other things as well. Now, I have one quote from Paul Balasik. Is that how you pronounce his name? Who was a modern dressage master, and this is what he said about the shoulder in. He said, the shoulder in one exercise, marries these two great lines of technical study, lateral balance and longitudinal balance. Garinere goes on to plate in a third strand of humanity, compassion, to come up with a beautiful braid, the art of dressage. That's what Balasik said. And this was also a statement attributed to Nuno Oliveira. The shoulder in, I love this one. This one I want you to comment on. The shoulder in is the aspirin of horseback riding. It cures everything.
Oh, I like that.
Isn't that a great statement? So what is the shoulder in, Jane?
So what is the shoulder in? Well, those of you who were here yesterday got a chance to see shoulder in. And a lot of times these movements like shoulder and sound so complicated and sound so mysterious, and we simplified it, demystified it yesterday by explaining that basically if you can ride a 10-meter circle, you can ride a shoulder in, because all a shoulder in is the first step of a 10-meter circle, and then you interrupt that circle and continue on a straight line. So the horse has the bend from nose to tail as if he's on the arc of a 10-meter circle, but you bring his shoulders in off the track at an angle of about 30 degrees, which puts the horse on what's called three tracks. In other words, if the horse was coming straight at me, I would see a separate track by the outside hind leg. I would not be able to see the inside hind leg because it would be hidden by the outside foreleg. So those two legs make their own track. And then the third track is the inside front leg. So the 30-degree angle puts the horse on three tracks. So we have a 10-meter bend and a 30-degree angle. Basically, the first step of a 10-meter circle continued on a straight line.
Why is that so good for a horse that it could be considered to fix any kind of a problem?
Yeah, it really is the aspirin. I think probably first and foremost, shoulder in is a straightening exercise.
Now, isn't that interesting? Because you're bending the horse in order to straighten him.
Yeah. All the horses I've ever met are by nature crooked. If you see a horse cantering in the paddock, generally they canter with their hindquarters to the inside. And often the rider thinks, well, in order to make my horse straight, because all the old riding masters, they say, straighten your horse and ride him forward, forward, straight, and calm. These are the foundation. This is the foundation that we live by. So often riders think, okay, the hindquarters are creeping to the inside. I think in order to make the horse straight, I'm going to bring my inside leg back and push those hindquarters over. And we never straighten the horse by pushing the hindquarters in line with the shoulders. We always straighten the horse by bringing the shoulder in, the shoulders over, in front of the hindquarters. Because basically when the horse is crooked, what they're trying to do is unload or unweight their inside hind leg. And so we make them straight by bringing the forehand in front of that inside hind leg so that they have to load that inside hind leg. So therefore, the shoulder in accomplishes so many things. We make the horse straight. It's also a strengthening exercise. If you think about weightlifting, we're bringing the forehand in front of that inside hind leg that the horse is trying to avoid carrying weight on. And it's like doing a deep knee bend and picking up weight. The other thing, and those of you who were here yesterday, you know, I talked about collection or self-carriage for horses in any discipline. We want the horse in self-carriage because a horse that carries himself is simply more athletic and can do his job better, whatever his job is, whether it's a jumping horse or an endurance horse or whatever. And so how do we shift that center of gravity back to the hind legs? Because as you saw yesterday, by nature, a horse carries 60% of his weight on his front legs and 40% of his weight on his hind legs. Well, the shoulder in, by virtue of that bend and that angle, remember, it's like a mathematical formula, the word bend and then make a little plus sign, and then the word sideways and make a little equal sign, engagement, okay? And the definition of engagement is the bending of the joints of the hind leg. So every step that the horse takes in shoulder in, he has to bend the joints of that inside hind leg. And so as he bends the joints of the inside hind leg, his croup lowers each time, or I should say the inside hip lowers so that the croup goes down. And as a result, just like a seesaw, the back end is going down, the front end is going up, and the horse is more like an airplane taking off, and you're creating that collection or self-carriage.
And the lightening of the front end,
exactly,
which is what you're trying to
accomplish.
Yeah, that's
exactly right.
What are the front feet doing? They're not really crossing over, are they?
No, nothing's crossing over.
Okay, it's just a reorientation of the spine, kind of. Basically, is it important to do the shoulder in equally both directions?
Absolutely. And this is one of the challenges of training, because most horses are like most people. They're left-handed or right-handed. And so we want to make the horses appear ambidextrous if we're developing them as athletes. So it's very, very important to do it in both directions. The challenge of that is that on the soft side of the horse, the side where he likes to bend a little bit more, the tendency when you try to ride shoulder in is that they bend their head and neck in. Yeah, I see heads nodding. You know, you've been there, done that. The neck comes in and the shoulder pops out. So rather than having shoulder in, we have head and neck in, shoulder falling out. On the stiff side of the horse, it's harder to get that 10-meter bend, but it's easier to move the shoulders over. So each side presents a different problem for you to solve.
In terms of the amount of time that you devote to each side, would you try and keep that pretty much the same, or would you be working a little bit more, just spending more time on the side that he's a little stiffer to?
No, I would spend equal amount of time on each side. It's just that I would approach it differently depending on the horse's needs.
Yeah. Interesting. And this is along an arena wall, right?
I mean, you can do this anywhere.
But the idea is you've got a track, a straight track that you're following.
And that's one of the things that's very helpful to have a track, because to get this engagement, this is difficult for the horse, and it's something that the strength has to be developed over time. So when you're first starting with shoulder in, the horses say, ooh, this is really hard. So they try to evade the difficulty of the movement, and they lose their bend. And the way that you can tell that they're losing their bend, if you do it along the long side of the arena, is that the hindquarters come at an angle to the arena. If your horse is truly bending, and you could only see the back end of the horse, you would not be able to tell from looking at the hindquarters if the horse is in shoulder in or if he's just walking or trotting straight down the track, because the position of the hindquarters should be identical. It should be parallel to the track. As soon as the hindquarters swing out and they're at an angle to the track, you have the sideways part of the formula, but you don't have the bend part. Therefore, you don't get any of that engagement of that inside hind leg.
Is it possible to overdo this as an exercise? How do you pace it so that you're not overstressing the horse?
I think it's possible to overdo anything you do with the horse. And the important thing is you're trying to establish a dialogue with your horse. You're trying to establish a language. And you have to listen to your horse. And if your horse starts to struggle and resist, then you have to think of ways to still get your point across, but somehow take the difficulty out of the exercise. For example, you do it in walk instead of trot. You do it with half the angle, maybe 15 degrees you bring the shoulders in rather than 30 degrees. You do 3 or 4 steps in the trot and then straighten the horse, let the horse relax a little bit, relax the muscles, and then you ask for 3 or 4 steps again. So you find ways to still challenge the horse with the exercise, but take the difficulty out of the exercise so you never bring the horse to the point where he's frustrated.
I'm talking with Jane Savoie about the shoulder in exercise. Okay, we know it's good. Now, how do you get it? What do you do with your hands, your feet, your seat when you ask your horse to do the shoulder in? I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. We'll be back.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A Horse Drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A Horse Drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A Horse Drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We do appreciate it, folks. Just a little thing you can do for us that makes such a difference. My guest is Jane Savoie. We're talking about the shoulder-in exercise of dressage. Jane, we know it's good. How do we get it? What are you doing with your hands and your feet and your seat when you're asking him to do the shoulder in? How do you cue him, in other words?
Okay, well, basically, remember, it's bend plus sideways. So first you have to think about your bending aids. You all know now from turning the key in the lock with that inside rein, you get flexion to the inside. But since horses are so flexible in the neck, we support with the outside rein. In order to get engagement of that inside hind leg, which is what shoulder in does, it's an engagement of the inside hind leg exercise. Your weight is on your inner seat bone. Your inner leg is on the girth as a pole for the horse to bend around. And your outer leg is behind the girth to help bend the back end of the horse around the inner leg, because that bend has to be equal from pole to tail. So that's how we get the bend element of the shoulder in. For the angle, we lead the shoulders off the track. Your hands stay equidistant from your body, and if you wanted to do right shoulder in, you would use an opening right rein and a bearing left rein. So both hands come to the right for right shoulder in. Right hand to the right, left hand to the right, two hands to the right, staying equidistant from your body. And that's how you add the angle part. So you have your bend from your circle aids, and then you lead the shoulder in the direction you want to take it.
Your trunk's a little bit rotated to the inside, correct?
Always to sit in harmony with your horse. Your shoulders should be parallel to the horse's shoulders and your hips parallel to the horse's hips. So if the horse is bent, in this case to the right, look at where my shoulders go, right shoulder is back.
What is the hardest part for people that are trying to learn to do this, either their own cueing mechanism or teaching their horse? I mean, in general, what is the hardest part of this?
That's a great question, because what often happens when the rider begins to bring the shoulders off the track, the horse says, I don't want to bend the joints of my inside hind leg and do a deep knee bend with that inside hind. So what they do is they drift toward the center of the ring. The rider feels that. And rather than logically understanding that their legs control the hind legs, and the reason the horse is drifting off the track is that he's trying to keep the joints of that inside hind leg open, so you need to fix that by using your inner leg and tucking, getting him to tuck that inside hind leg underneath him. What the rider does instead, feeling the horse drifting to the inside, takes that inner hand and brings it toward the wall in order to hold the horse on the wall, rather than keeping that inner hand as an opening rein, which leads the shoulder in. So they start to use their rein aid in a place where you should actually be using your leg aid. That's the biggest mistake that I see, especially on the hollow side of the horse.
You wouldn't move your leg back to kind of push him back towards the wall?
Rick, Now, think about that.
Okay, go ahead. Explain it to me.
Think about our equation, bend plus sideways. If your inner leg is back, there's no pole for the horse to bend around. Your inside leg
has to be... True, but if he's drifting out that way, wouldn't you want him to go back the other way?
No, you want to get him... He's drifting out that way because he's opening the joints of the mm-hmm. hind leg. So you keep mm-hmm. your inside leg on the girth, and you apply it. You use it actively, squeeze, release, to get him to bend that leg and tuck it underneath.
Okay.
So, okay, sorry.
Oh, no, that's okay.
Thoroughly chastised, isn't he?
We're all here to learn.
Don't you ever... But you know what? That's a good point. I was saying that the biggest mistake riders make is they take that inner hand and they bring it as an indirect rein aid. But actually...
I made the biggest mistake. Is that what you're
about
to say?
No, I was going to say Rick, in his brilliance, came up with the biggest mistake riders make is that they bring that inside leg back. And basically, you're doing a leg yield in shoulder in position, which is fine if you want to do a leg yield. But as you know from yesterday, a leg yield is a wonderful exercise as a loosening, stretching, warm-up, toe-touching type exercise. But it has nothing to do with engagement because there is no bend. So actually... You're absolutely right.
See,
that's the worst.
That.
I know you knew that. You were just setting me up for that. That's the worst mistake that the rider can make is bring that inside leg back. The second worst mistake is using that indirect inside rein.
All righty. Well, this is the point where we open it up to questions from you, the audience. Does anybody have a question they'd like to start us off with? And I'll come to you with the microphone for our radio audience to partake of your wisdom.
So the correction, rather than either pulling the hand back or... moving the
correction
right,
for what?
The correction for the horse drifting to the inside and going the direction that you're trying to do the shoulder in is to use an active, to go from a passive inside leg to an active inside leg and press and release.
Absolutely.
Whereas at first it's just holding the horse.
Yes, it's just there as passively on the girth as a pole for the horse to bend around. But when he tries to drift in because he doesn't want to bend his hind leg, his inside hind leg, then that inside leg on the girth switches from being passively placed there to active squeeze, release.
Thank you.
Yeah, good question.
All right, who else?
Now, the horse who has the flexible neck and who wants to bring his neck in and let his shoulder go out, the correction is going to be the outside rein, is it not? Is that going to be the deal here as far as to keep him from bulging out on that shoulder and just waving his head to the inside of the arena?
Yes, that's absolutely right. But that is a wonderful question because, you know, if you haven't felt the correct thing ever, it's hard to know what you're looking for. So what I often have riders do, and you will not have bend really when you do this, but on that hollow side of the horse, the soft side of the horse, the side where he wants to bend his neck and pop the shoulder out, I will have riders ride that shoulder in counterflexion. And you learned yesterday that flexion happens at the pole. So let's say you come through the corner, flex the horse at the pole to the outside. That will give you control over the horse's shoulders. It will give you the ability to slide the shoulders in. And then you'll feel, when you feel the shoulders softly between the two reins, not leaning on that outside rein, that's a feeling you can then recreate with correct flexion at the pole, which is the flexion to the inside. But that's a wonderful rider exercise. You're right. In theory, if you have a lot of experience with shoulder in, all you need to do is have more influence of outside rein. If you've never felt good shoulder in on the hollow side of the horse, do it in counterflexion so that you can feel your ability to mobilize the shoulders and bring them to the inside. And then once you've learned that feeling, go back to correct flexion.
Anybody else? Question? Yes, ma'am.
Something I have always mused about in shoulder in, I'd like you to comment on, is that when we're weighting our inside seat bone, because we want the horse's shoulders to go to the inside. At the same time, we always talk about weighting the seat bone in the direction that we want the horse to travel, and we want them to travel down the track. So I've always wondered about that.
Well, I wanted to just say two things about your question. In leg yields, which have no bend, we weight the seat bone in the direction we want the horse to go, and that's normally the seat bone opposite the leg that's behind the girth. Okay, that's for leg yields. And you said, well, you know, we weight the seat bone to influence the shoulders. You weight the seat bone to influence that inside hind leg to help with the engagement of the inside hind leg. So the weighting of the inside seat bone, which is part of your bending aid on a circle, That has nothing to do with affecting the shoulders. It has to do with affecting the inside hind leg. As far as sending the horse in the direction you want to go, this is not a leg yield, you do that with the driving of your inner leg and with your eyes, because the horse will go where you look, and with your will. It's a thing of the mind as well, that rather than continuing along the arc of that 10-meter circle, you send the horse with your mind and with your eyes and with your inner leg in the direction that you want him to go. But in order to keep the bend, as if you're on a circle, the weight has to be on your inside seat bone to create that engagement of the inside hind.
Well, I'll take this opportunity to do a little commercial, first of all, for Wall Clippers. They have sponsored me for many years and are an absolutely wonderful company, very committed to education in the equestrian industry. And obviously, they sponsor events like this and a number of clinicians and so forth. This particular one that we're going to give away here today is about a $60 or $70 item. It's called the Wall Pro Series Rechargeable Clipper. You can use it either with a cord or without. So it's particularly handy if you're teaching a horse to tolerate clipping. You don't have to worry about stepping all over the cord. So, Jane.
Oh, I get to
go
pick,
ahead and
huh?
Draw. Don't peek.
Okay, Cat Armitage.
Oh, my God. I never win anything. There you go. Power of positive thinking right there. You like somebody who's happy about winning. You got to love that. Your website, janesavoie.com?
Yes.
My website, ricklamb.com or thehorseshow.com. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Jane, for being with us today.
Oh, you're very welcome. My pleasure.
And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Special thanks to my guest today, Ms. Sammi Jo Stohler. And by the way, her updated website, in the interview she gave one website, it has since changed, and I want to be sure you have the current one. It's zebraguru.com, Z-E-B-R-A-G-U-R-U. .com. Sometimes websites change, so I want to be sure you have the current one. Thanks also to Ms. Jane Savoie. Her website, of course, Jane Savoie, SAVOIE.com. That is not likely to change because I don't think her name's going to change. Anyway, thanks to both of my guests. Thanks to Wall Clippers for supporting our expo tour. And if you would like more information about what I am doing, where I'm going to be, the watch my TV show, listen to past editions of the radio show, read my blog, all of that stuff, you can do so at thehorseshow.com, and be sure you sign up to be a member. It's absolutely free, and it gets you my e-blast every single week. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.